As Paolo says, I will present some results obtained in different studies related with occurrence and behavior of brominated flame retardants in Spain. I am coming from the environmental department in the one of the departments of Institute of Environmental Assessment and Water Research from the CSIC in Barcelona, Spain. And our laboratory is focused on the development of different analytical methodologies in order to determine the new emerging contaminants, all kind of organic emerging contaminants. So one part of my, first of all, the results that I will present is the results of research of different people, two PhD students, Agustina de la Cal and Paula Berra, and also work with a sewage postdoc student, Goran Marsh. The outline of the presentation will be the following. First of all, a brief introduction about the different brominated flame retardants. And then I will focus some part of my presentation dealing with the analytical problems and the analytical developments that we need in order to obtain more interesting information about some of the brominated flame retardants. And finally, I will show you some case studies in different areas of Spain. Well, I think that most of you knows that flame retardants are materials added or applied to a material in order to increase the fire resistance of that product. There are different flame retardants, but the 25% of all the flame retardants that are used are brominated compounds, and their applications are different. They are applied in electronic, plastics, paper, wood, textiles, and others. The main brominated flame retardants used are the tetrabromobisphenol A. Then the three different mixtures of polybrominated diphenylethers, the penta, octa, and deca mixture, and also the hexabromocyclododecan, the HBCD. But it should be pointed that the penta and octa mixture have been banned in Europe since 2004, and that because their consumption has dropped in Europe and the shift in production towards other brominated retardants took place. And this is the case of HBCD and also for the DECA BDA mixture. Here we have the different chemical structure of the main brominated flame retardants, the polybrominated diphenyl ethers, that is a family comprising 209 different congeners, depending on the number of bromine and also the different situation in the molecule. So the nomenclature for PBDs is the same that we are always know for PCBs. As regards the hexabromocyclododecan, there are different isomers, but the isomers present in technical mixture are three, the alpha, beta, and gamma. And then we have the tetrabromobisphenol A, that is the bisphenol A with four bromine atoms. It should be pointed also that there are a lot of emerging BFLs. These are the new challenge for analytical scientists, that we need to develop analytical methods in order to be able to determine these new brominated flame retardants in order to know which is the actual occurrence in the environment for all these new brominated flame retardants. Special attention must be paid on this one, is the decabromodiphenylethan, and this one is the substitute for the DECA-BDA. One of the advantages of this compound is that when it was incinerated, it doesn't produce the brominated and the brominated dioxins and furans. But the problem is that there are some studies that show that there is also bioavailable, and we can find also in biota samples. Well, As regards the analytical determinations, we have different steps. First of all, the sampling, then the extraction of the sample. Normally, the traditional extraction method is the SOXLED, but during the last years, we have tried to find methods that were shorter than the SOXLED, because SOXLED takes 4 hours. At minimum. So normally we are working now with micro-assisted extraction or pressurized liquid extraction. Then we need to do the cleanup of the extracts, and also here we try to find also more automated systems working with different solid phase extraction cartridges. Then, once we have the cleaned extracts, we move to the instrumental determination. When we talk about the instrumental determination of persistent organic pollutants, we are always talking about the GC coupled to mass spectrometry. But there are some new POPs, such as HBCD or tetrabromobisphenol A, and also the perfluorinated compounds that now need to develop analytical methods based on the liquid chromatography. In any case, when we use gas chromatography or liquid chromatography, we need to couple it with mass spectrometry. For the PBD determinations, we can find different approaches of mass spectrometry. We can work with electron impact or negative chemical ionization. We can also work with low resolution mass spectrometry or high resolution mass spectrometry. And also we have an alternative using ion trap MS. In the case of liquid chromatography, it's mandatory to work with tandem mass spectrometry and MSMS in order to achieve the required sensitivity for the environmental levels that we found usually. And finally, the quantification, there are works applying the external standard calibration or internal standard calibration, but when it will be possible, it's always better to work with isotopic dilution technique. This technique was based on the use of labeled compounds. Well, now I will show you some of the developed methods in our lab. For sediment samples, we have developed a very rapid analytical method. We lyophilize and homogenize the sediment sample, and then we use a selective pressurized liquid extraction. That means that we could carry out simultaneously the extraction and purification. And that was carried out introducing in the cell of the system. We mix our sediment sample with one adsorbent. In this case, we use the alumina. And this cell extraction was introduced in our system. We have optimized the solvent extraction, the temperature, as well as the pressure of the methods. And in this case, we can obtain a cleaned extract in only 25 minutes. And then we move to the instrumental analysis by GCMS. We have compared the analytical parameters using the new selective pressurized liquid extraction versus the traditional method using SOXLED extraction followed by solid phase extraction with alumina cartridge. And as can be seen, the analytical parameters are very similar for both techniques, with good recoveries, good variability, and also similar detection limits. The problem is when we move to more complex matrices like biota samples. In this case, the selective pressurized liquid extraction doesn't work well because this matrix is more complicated. In this case, we need to do a normal pressurized liquid extraction with the same conditions that we have optimized before. But then we need to introduce one step in order to do the fat removal. Basically, this removal was achieved with an acid attack with sulfuric acid. Then we need to do the purification step with SP cartridge, and then finally we can do the instrumental analysis. Well, for the instrumental determination for PBDs, we can find in the literature a lot of works working with negative chemical ionization and other ones working with electron impact. Each one of these approaches have the advantages and also disadvantages. In the case of negative chemical ionization, the major signal is always the bromine atom. So when we do the mass spectrometric analysis, we select these 79 and 81 corresponding to the bromine atom. But the problem is that all the brominated components in the samples will then a signal using this mass. So there is no structural information in our analysis. But in contrast, we have a very good sensitivity of this ionization mode. When we use the electron impact MS, we have a lot of structural information because we have the simultaneous detection of the molecular ion as well as fragmentation products. So the masses that we select for the penta will be different for the hexa, for the hepta, and so on. So we can differentiate better between the different congeners of PBDs. The problem is the low sensitivity of this technique. So here we have the detection limits when we work in negative chemical ionization and when we work with electron impact. As you can see, here we talk about femtograms. These are instrumental detection limits. But here we move to the picograms. One technique that we have that could be could have both advantages is the ion trap MS, because here we have the same structural information that we have when we work with electron impact, but also we have similar detection limits that those are obtained with negative chemical ionization. So the ion trap MS could be a good alternative for the PBD determinations. This is a table with a summary of the capabilities of all the different GCMS approaches used for PBD determinations. Obviously, the best technique is always the electron impact working with high-resolution MS. We have a good sensitivity, a good confirmation, and a good accuracy using isotopic dilution method. But the problem of this technique is the very high cost of the instruments, and normally the laboratories are not able to have this instrumentation. The negative chemical ionization, electron impact, and as I said before, the ion trap MS is a good alternative in sensitivity, confirmation, and accuracy of the technique. What happens when we want to analyze other flame retardants by GCMS, when we want to analyze tetrabromobisphenol A and HBCD by GCMS? In the case of tetrabromobisphenol A, we need to add a derivatization step before injecting the sample in the chromatographic system. And another problem is that tetrabromobisphenol A collude with the hexa BDE 153. In the case of HBCD, we have a coelution of the three isomers, the alpha, beta, and gamma, in the same chromatographic peak. So we cannot do an isomeric specific determination of this HBCD. Another problem of the HBCD is that the congeners of HBCD are thermally labile, and when we apply the high GC oven and injector temperatures, there is an interconversion and also appears breakdown products of the HBCD in our chromatogram. The problem is that these breakdown products are in the same retention time that one of the BDE, most important because it's one of the principal BDEs present in the penta mixture, the penta BDE 99. As we can see in the presentation of this morning about the natural brominated compounds, we have the methoxylated PBDs that have natural origin. They are being formed by sponges and algae. And they have been found in marine environments, especially the methoxylated BDE-47 and the methoxylated BDE-68 being the most abundant. But there are other methoxylated PBDs that can be detected at concentrations comparable or higher than those obtained for PBDs. So it's also interesting to introduce these compounds in our analytical methodology. So that because we have developed a GCMS method, including some PBDs, but also some emerging brominated flame retardants, such the decabromodiphenyl ethan, also the hexabromobenzene, and also some of the most some of the methoxylated BD congeners. So in one extract sample preparation and one injection in the system, we can determine the concentration of all these compounds. Well, for the HBCD, the stereochemistry of this component is very complicated. Theoretically, there are 16 possible stereoisomers. There are six pairs of enantiomers and two mesoforms. But this is theoretically the commercial mixture is formed by the alpha, beta, and gamma isomers. And it should be pointed that the physicochemical properties of these isomers are different. For instance, here we could see the water solubility of the alpha, beta, and the gamma. And this could lead to a differential behavior in the environment. So, in order to be able to determine the isomers of the HBCD, we need to use the liquid chromatography. Here we show a standard mixture with the alpha, beta, and gamma in three separate peaks. This was done optimizing the method with an hybrid system, liquid system, with a quadrupole and a linear ion trap. And we have optimized the conditions of the system, selecting the best transition, and working with a symmetry column C18. But as I said before, these compounds are pairs of enantiomers, so it could be also important to determine not only the isomers, but also the enantiomers. So if we want to determine enantiomers of HBCD, we must work with a chiral column, and then we have the minus alpha, minus beta, plus alpha, plus beta, plus gamma, and minus gamma. We have the three pairs of enantiomers correctly separated in our chromatogram. As Begonia said before, when we work with enantiomers, the interest is to determine the enantiomeric fraction, which is defined by this equation. But the problem when we work with liquid chromatography, and especially when we work with electrospray ionization, it is well know that there are matrix effect leading to an ion suppression of our signal. So we need to use isotopic level at the standards of the HBCD in order to have a corrected value of enantiomeric fraction. So this equation was transformed in this one, in which we correct the potential matrix effect applying the areas also of the labeled standard compounds. So this is very important in order to obtain a real value of enantiomeric fraction. Well, and for the tetrabromobisphenol A, we need also to analyze by liquid chromatography. We have developed a method in which we can determine the tetrabromobisphenol A, but also the different products, the related products by losses of bromine, the 3D mono, and just to lead into the bisphenol A. So the method that we have developed includes these compounds, the tetra, 3D, mono, and bisphenol A, but simultaneously with the alpha, beta, and gamma HBCD. So we can analyze tetrabromobisphenol A and HBCD simultaneously. And here we can see the different labeled compounds that we use for the quantification. Well, and after this introducing on the different analytical methods that we apply for determining brominated flame retardants, I will show you some of the studies. First of all, the occurrence of brominated flame retardants in the Ebro River Basin. This work was carried out within an integrated European Union project, the Aquaterra project, in which more than 15 different partners of different countries of Europe were involved. And the task of our laboratory was to study the Ebro River Basin, analyzing different emerging contaminants. And in my case, I have a focus on the brominated flame retardants, but not only in all the Ebro River Basin, but especially in some risk zones. As Begoña said before, the Finca River near to the Monzon area is one of these risk zones. We have selected different sampling sites along the Finca River. Here we have Monzon, a heavily industrialized town with a very important chemical industry. So we have selected two sampling sites as control upstream of Monzon, and then two sample sites downstream Monzon. But we have also carried out another sampling site along the Vero River, a tributary of the Finca River, taking into account Barbastro, but it is another industrial town. And here we have selected one control site and two sites downstream of the potential contamination site. First of all, we have analyzed sediment samples at each of these selected sites. And we have found, in the case of the Finca River, a very high HBCD contamination. So the HBCD was not detected in the control site, but we have a very high contamination in points 3 and 4. And in the case of Barbastro, the contamination was different, and in this case, we have found a high concentration of DECA-BDE. So this was an ideal situation in order to study the behavior of this DECA-BDE and this HBCD in order to know the behavior in the environment and in biotic samples. It should be pointed that when this project starts, all the information related to brominated flame retardants was focused on the PBDEs, but not on the DECA-BDE and not on the HBCD. Well, after identifying the source of the contaminated areas, we have selected different sampling campaigns, starting in 2002, another campaign in 2004 and 2005. We have selected sediments and different biota samples. The fish that we have analyzed depend a lot of on the availability when the sampling campaigns were carried out. It's not always easy to find fish samples in some of the areas. For instance, here in the most contaminated area, we didn't find any fish. So we have analyzed different matrices, abiotic matrices, the sediment samples, but also we want to understand which is the source of contamination of these two high contamination areas. So we have analyzed some industrial effluents in different industries that we suspect that could be the responsible of the contamination. And then we have analyzed biota samples. In some cases, we analyze the whale fish, and in other cases, the muscle or the liver. And the analysis the determinations that we have carried out are the PBDEs, that including the DKBD and the HBCD. Another parameters that we have determined are the organic carbon for the sediment samples and the lipid content for fish samples. In order to identify source of contamination in the area of Monzón, we have selected two potential industries. One is dealing with the production of EPS that was treated with flame retardants, and the other one produced the PVC. In the case of the Barbastro, for the Vero River, we have selected three industries. One, a textile industry that produces polyester fibers treated also with flame retardants. And another one for the production of epoxy resins, and the third one dealing with the polyamide polymerization. So analyzing the industrial effluents, clearly we can identify the source of contamination. In the case of the HBCD contamination, the industry producing the EPS treated with flame retardants was the responsible of the contamination. In the case of the DKBD, it could be see that the three different industries works with the DKBD, but the main contaminated was that related with the polyamide polymerization. Well, as I said before, when we started with this study, there were a lot of environmental questions related with the DKBD. Some people say that the DKBD is not an environmental problem because the high molecular size of this molecule doesn't allow the transfer through the cellular membrane, so it is not bioavailable. But here we will show you that the DKBD yes is bioavailable also. At this moment, there were some experiments with cached fish carried out by using trout and carp. They were dietary exposed to DKBD, and they showed a slow but some uptake of the DKBD, but also they showed that the presence of lower brominated compounds, for instance, the ExaBD 154. But these are laboratory experimental studies. Here there is the results for sediment samples carried out in November 2004 and 1 year later in 2005. As can be seen, the concentration levels of BDE at sites controls, the 1 and the V1, are the normally found in other rivers or in other locations of Europe or around the world. But when we move to the source of contamination, these levels were very high, and we can see that the levels increased considerably between one year to the other one. If we compare our concentration levels, here we have 12 micrograms per gram of sediment. We can see that they are very high compared with other DKBD studies near industry facilities here in Sweden, in United Kingdom, and the Netherlands. So this is a very high contamination. It should be pointed also that the Vero River is a small river with a very low flow rate, and that because we think that the contamination is leading to these very high levels in sediment samples. Well, for the biota sample, as I said before, the DECA was detected in biota sample, showing that this compound, yes, is bioavailable in 9 out of the 10 different samples that we have collected in the first sampling campaign. We can detect the DECA BDE at concentration levels ranging between 20 and more than 200 nanograms per gram lipid weight. And there is the same effect that we see with sediment samples, an increase of contamination with time, because 1 year later, the concentration levels of the DECA BDE reach up to 700 nanogram per gram lipid weight. These levels also, if we compare with the three only studies that also showed the presence of DECA BDE in aquatic biota, our results are also the very the higher results compared with those carried out in Germany and also in the Baltic Sea. But another important question is not only the concentration levels that we found, but also the behavior, the different PBD congenital patterns that we found. Here, in the control site, we have the percentage contribution of the different PBD congeners that we have detected. And as can be seen, the most important contribution is related to the tetra BD47. And this is the typical congener pattern in different fish collected around the world in areas with not local source contamination. But when we see the distribution in the contaminated areas, we can see, first of all, that we could detect the DECA BDE, but also the contribution of the tetra BDE47 decreased considerably. And one important question is also the contribution of the EXA BDE154, this one. Is very low in the control site, but this percentage increase in the area contaminated with DECA BDE. If we remember the study with cached carps that are exposed to the DECA BDE, they found also some lower brominated compounds, specifically the hexabromodiphenyl ether 154. So our study could confirm these studies in the laboratory. We have also calculated the fish to sediment ratio for the different BDE. And as it was expected, the fish to sediment ratio decreased with increase the degree of bromination. But we can see that the DECA BDE has a low fish to sediment ratio, but there is also bioavailable. Well, now we move to the other contaminated area. In this case, the contaminated area for the hexabromous cyclododecan. Here also there was some environmental questions. The three isomers present in the technical mixture are the alpha, beta, and gamma, but this is the pattern from the different isomers, with a high contribution of the gamma isomers, more than 70%, and low percentage for the alpha and beta. This is the same distribution that we can find in sediment samples, as can be seen here. But when we move to biotic samples, the congenital pattern changes completely, and we can find a low contribution of the gamma and a very high contribution of the alpha isomers. So is alpha more bioavailable than gamma isomer? We don't know. Or probably there is a biotransformation occurring from gamma to the alpha. Well, here we have the results related to the HBCD contaminated area, with results for sediment and for fish sample in October 2002 and November 2004. We can see also an increase of contamination with time, with sediment samples here 500 nanogram per gram dry weight, and here 1,600 nanogram per gram dry weight. And also the same behavior for the fish samples, with concentration, here very high concentration of the HBCD in the fish sample collected. Also the comparison with other studies for HBCD in different countries. In this case, there are all of them European countries, but results another time there are very high compared with the available data at this time of the study. Here we have represent, as you know, the fish length and weight are directly related to the fish age. So we have represent the fish length versus the HBCD concentration, as well as the fish weight versus the HBCD concentration. And a linear correlation was obtained showing that HBCD be accumulated in these fish samples. As regards the isomeric pattern for the samples of contamination with HBCD, we have the typical congenital pattern in sediment with very low contribution of the alpha and very high contribution of the gamma isomer. When we move to the fish, this pattern changes a little bit, but not so expected as the pattern that I showed you before, when the alpha was the predominant in fish sample. This could be related to a recent exposure that received these fish samples. We have carried out also a depuration study in the laboratory, exposing zebrafish to the industrial effluent that caused the contamination, but diluted. And we have exposed the zebrafish for 12 days. And then we have carried out the depuration with millipore water for 9 days and 16 days. So we can see the concentrations in zebrafish for the alpha, beta, gamma, and the total HBCD. As can be seen, the depuration rates for alpha and for beta were 46 and 27% after 9 days of depuration, and were lower than that observed for the gamma isomer. Here we have 70% of depuration. So this could be one of the explanations because we found more alpha isomer in biotic samples, because the depuration of gamma is faster than that of the alpha isomer. Well, and now I will show you another different study. In this case, we have studied the HBCD in human bodies. And in this case, we want to know the isomeric, the concentration levels, but also the isomeric distribution, and also the enantiomeric distribution of HBCD in human bodies. For the, there are some papers in the literature that show that the HBCD has a different enantiomeric distribution depending on the species that we analyze. In this case, we have an enantiomeric fraction near to racemic, enantiomeric fraction of 0.5, but in this case, the enantiomeric fraction higher than 0.5 show an enantioselective accumulation in biota. And that because we want, in the laboratory, we want to know which happens with human bodies. We have analyzed for this purpose 33 human breast milk samples. The first that we can say is that in 31 samples we can detect the HBCD. In one sample we can detect that the concentration levels are below the limit of quantification, but for the rest, the 30 samples, we can quantify the alpha, and the beta was not detected in any samples, but the alpha and gamma HBCD. The levels reach up to 188 nanogram per gram lipid weight in the most contaminated sample. In this study, well, here also we compare with the literature in other countries. There are only these studies in human breast milk in 2007 in Sweden, Norway, Mexico, Canada, USA, Japan, Russia, and France, and another one. Our levels were the highest for all the published data. As regards the isomeric pattern, for some sample we have a predominance of gamma HBCD, but in other samples, in six samples, the dominance changed to the alpha HBCD. So there is an inconsistency in the isomeric pattern that may be due to individual variability in metabolizing capacity, or also to unknown factors such as the frequency of the HBCD exposure of each of the selected models. But this inconsistency was also seen in other studies. As regards the enantiomeric analysis, here we have the chromatogram for the standard mixture in which we have the racemic, the same amount of the minus and plus enantiomers. Here, one human milk with predominance of the gamma isomer with plus and minus gamma, and this one sample with the predominance of alpha isomer with the plus with the minus and plus alpha enantiomers. We have calculated the enantiomeric fractions for the samples for alpha HBCD and gamma HBCD, and we have compared with the enantiomeric fractions of the standard solutions where we have the racemic mixture. So it was expected at 0.5 for the standard solution. This is okay. But we can see in the case of the alpha HBCD, the enantiomeric fraction were in the range of 0.1 and 0.2. So it is clear here that there is an enantioselective accumulation in human bodies, leading to an enrichment of the minus HBCD enantiomer. In the case of gamma HBCD, there is no a clear behavior. We can see that if we see the mean value is near to the racemic, also to the racemic value of 0.5. But if we don't use the median values, but we separate in different groups. We can find some groups with an enantiomeric fraction of 0.5, but other ones with slightly enrichment of one of the enantiomers of some other with enrichment of the other one. So here it is not very clear, and there is a need for more analysis in this sense in order to confirm that the minus alpha is which was enantiomeric selective in human bodies, and also to clarify which happens with the gamma enantiomers. But in any case, it is evident that we need to include the isomeric and if it's possible, also the enantiomeric analysis of HBCD in the different monitoring that we will carry out with biotic samples and human samples, because we will see which is the real problem of the, which is the real compounds that accumulate in biotic and human samples in order to focus the toxicological studies in this compound, because it's not the same the toxicity of one enantiomer and the other one. Finally, we have do an estimation of dietary intake with the results that we have obtained for HBCD in human milk samples, and take into account the daily intake of 700 grams of milk per day, also the body weight for a baby of 1 month, and the mean value of lipid weight in our samples of the mean value of HBCD concentration, that lead to a dietary intake for a nursing of 175 nanograms per kilo weight and per day. The problem here, we want to compare this intake with other routes of exposition and also for different groups of populations, but the data available in the literature for this exposition in humans is very scarce, so we must compare our results in Spain with results of other exposure in other countries. So we have the human intake through the diet calculated for Sweden, Netherlands, UK and Norway, and also we have the ingestion, the intake via the breast ingestion for a baby. We can see that the daily intake of HBCD by breastfeeding is greater than that for the adult population for the diet, and also the food intake represent approximately the 80% exposure for a nursing infant. So we need to control the concentration levels of HBCD of all the pups, but also for the HBCD in human milk samples. Well, finally, I want to acknowledge the different financial support that we have for do all these studies. The European Union under the Aquaterra project, also the Spanish Ministry of Education and Science, the Fundación BBVA, and finally, a special acknowledgement to the Confederación Hidrográfica del Ebro, is the authority responsible of the management of the Ebro River Basin, and they add a lot of in order to be able to have the industrial effluence in order to identify the source contamination industries. And also, thank you all of you for your attention.
Lisa, I enjoyed your talk very, very much. It was extremely helpful, I think. I have one question. Do you have any idea what is the reason for this enormous high concentration of hexabromyl cyclobutadiene in Spanish population?
We don't know, because the samples were collected only in the north, in Galicia, in the north of Spain, and we don't have more results in other sites of Spain. We have some samples analyzed in Barcelona, and the levels were lower than these levels. But what we don't know why these samples from coming from Galicia are so high.
I have heard about big differences with respect to contamination of population for PVDEs. We know that PVDEs in the US population is 10 times, 20 times higher compared to Europe. But I expected for hexabromocyclodecane a relatively similar distribution worldwide, but this is really exciting.
I'm impressed with so much results you have, and I'm very interested in this kind of equipment are being used in your institution for differentiate PAHs derivatives like nitro PAHs, oxy PAH, or whatever.
Also in our laboratory now we are working developing the analytical method for hydroxylated PVDs, but using the liquid chromatography, because a lot of studies derivatize the hydroxylated PVDs, and there are a lot of problems in this step. So we think for the metabolites of PCBs, PVDs, etc., it's better to directly analyze by liquid chromatography.
I mentioned about PAHs, polycyclic aromatic acids, or the derivatives from them.
Mm-hmm.
Are you using this in your institution or
our laboratory was focused on emerging contaminants, so we don't analyze more the PAHs. Other groups in my institute, yes, but not in my laboratory. Professor Bayona works with PAH.
You have looked to different industries, and I think for the polymers there were three industries, and one had high emissions of the DKBP, and the other two you didn't find high emissions. Did you also screen for other brominated flame retardants there?
No, because at this time we have only the analytical methods for PVDs and HPCD. We think that in one of the industries, I think they use the tetrabromobisphenol A, but at this time we didn't have the analytical method ready to analyze it.